which is a pun, his name is Minimus, which means very small, and moose means mouse in Latin, get it? It's the Minimus, right? Easy stories about characters where they can start to see grammar, start to learn endings. And they start memorizing things. And throughout the book, we keep hearing about how things need to be hard, how there's value in memorization, value in things that are difficult. How anything worth knowing comes at a price, often an exacting one paid over many years. Some students in the audience might feel their own lives passing by their eyes out of this speech here. Years and years of toil and struggle. The consequences reach far. People have a common culture. And as an author that he cited several times has written, a culture of the classical kind strives for fixed grandeur, dignity, authority, and high polish, while an individual produces morality and peace by showing them that values are rooted in the universe rather than dependent upon his fallible and changing judgment. And this is the essence of classical humanism. And he argues throughout the book that the only path is through the optative, not just by looking at the Parthenon. So in later years in elementary and then in junior high school and in high school, our program keeps climbing as well. We use the Cambridge Latin course and we move on to Wheelock's Latin, where memorization, drilling, and all of the other things that aren't relevant or useful are the core of the class, where we try to mimic what learning was like in the ancient world and in other times, when teaching was strict and the learning hard. How do we do this? Why do we do this? Waiting at the far end of the journey would be civilized human beings, citizens who had learned what their culture was about and what it needed to conserve. It may be telling that we do not find many instances in the ancient world of people setting to write their own poems. Their task was not to express themselves, but to bow humbly at the feet of others. They were apprentices. They were to know, not to be known. So we drill, we memorize, we practice. And we don't just say, write whatever you want. We don't just let people do whatever they want. We have a prescribed curriculum. And the climb. We're always going to be talking about the climb. So I've been to Delphi a few times. And the ascent at Delphi is amazing. Amazing both up and down. And that's what we're talking about in this book, is the importance of the ascent and the struggle. And then, of course, the payoff as well, whether or not we get to the top. So Latin, what's so hard about it? What do they have to memorize? What is all this drilling anyway, right? Well, also, if you're going to learn a little Latin real quick. Or a review for some of you guys with a testimony. What is it about Latin that makes it so important and so structured and so helpful? He only devotes a couple pages to this where they actually do some prose composition. He zooms by it in about a page. Latin is complicated. When we learn vocabulary, we learn three things, not two things. We learn a lexical form. We learn English definitions and, of course, the usefulness part. We learn all of these English words that are derived from them. Words, like nouns, aren't a verb. They're a word, and an ending, and a gender. And every time a student learns a noun, they're not learning one piece of information. They're learning its nominative singular. And they're learning its genitive singular, with which they can deduce which kind of noun it is, and therefore, which set of endings it must take. And, of course, anyone familiar with other languages, be it German, French, Spanish, are well aware of the importance of grammatical gender, which, of course, must be memorized, not always easily deduced. And, of course, there are several different types of nouns in Latin, all of which must be memorized independent of each other. We keep climbing. And as we climb, we see more and more. We see more and more up, we see more and more down. And at some point, we realize how many endings we must memorize. How we need to know our I, arm, I, arm, is, os, is, our us, e, o, o, e, or, is, os, is, e, o, o, ar, or, is, os, e, I'm sorry, ar, or, is, ah, is, blank, is, e, m, a, ace, ibis, ace, ibis, blank, is, e, blank, a, Ha-om-ivasa-ilas. And then, of course, the weird ones. The ones we don't even use in English at all, like us, us, ui, oo, us, uum, ibus, us, ibus. And everybody's favorite, the fourth declension neuter nouns. Ooh, us, ooh, ooh, ooh. Ua, uum, ibus, ua, ibus. And of course, our very rare, but most important declension, the fifth declension, ace, adi, adi, m, a, ace, arum, abus, ace, abus. I could have called on a number of students in the audience to do that. What are all these endings? Well, declensions are groups. And there's only five of them, and all their subsets. Nouns are declined. What does that mean? Why? The groups are simple. You got nouns that are declined in different ways. We've got two declensions of nouns in English. We call them regular and irregular. And we decline for number. Man becomes men, or goose becomes geese. Boy becomes boys, and we decline for possessivity with a apostrophe answer as apostrophe. Singulars and plurals are easily deduced. You've got your singular endings, you've got your plural endings, but what on earth are these? We have these in English. They're called cases, but only our pronouns have them anymore. Do we ever mess up he versus him? Do we ever hear somebody say, between you and I, and you know it's between you and me because it's the object of a preposition and therefore it must be in the objective case? Do you know that the correct grammar is, it is I, because I is a subject complement and therefore it must be in the subjective case? Do you know when to use a possessive pronoun, like it is mine, as opposed to a possessive adjective, it is my book? We decline our pronouns. I, my, mine, me, they, theirs, their, them. But we don't talk about that. We don't do charts in English because we all know English already, right? And we never make any grammatical mistakes. So the case system is very simple. Endings show grammar. Subjects go in the nominative. Possession, you put it in the genitive. An indirect object goes in the dative. The direct object goes in the accusative, and then are, of course, millions of ablative usages. I'm really tempted to get a couple kids to rattle off a few, but we all know our ablative means, ablative of manner, ablative of time when, ablative of time within which, ablative of degree of difference, ablative of absolute, ablative of comparison, ablative of respect, to name a few. This is exactly what he's talking about. You can't figure the grammar out without doing the memorization. You can't fudge it. The endings show all the grammar. You have a subject before a direct object. You have a direct object before the verb. You have an indirect object followed by a subject followed by a direct object. And four prepositional phrases later, you have a verb. How can you deduce grammar? By looking and analyzing every single ending. One cannot take Latin and not benefit from English grammar. So we keep climbing. And some students, every once in a while, have the little lightning bolt. I get it. That's called looking down. I always say it's cheating. Don't look down. Get to the top. But everybody cheats. If you're doing the hike, you've got to look down. Look at that view. Students become frustrated sometimes. Students want to give up. Students say, I can't do it. I can't memorize it. It's too much. It's too hard. My usual glib response is, people have been memorizing these endings for 2,400 years. You can totally memorize these endings. And we can joke about it, of course, and kind of half believe it at the same time. And some drop out. They don't get to the top. They're not even halfway at the top. But others persevere. Well, that's one of our character ed things as well, isn't it? Why all this grammar? What does grammar do? Grammar bestowed, in the words of the 15th century scholar Nicholas Perotti, ars recte loquendi recteque scribendi, the art of correct speaking and writing, and was therefore the initium et fundamentum omnium disciplinarum, beginnings and basis of all knowledge. Grammar was not a job to be eased or escaped, but a task to be mastered, and mastered before all else. Just Just imagine going to school and doing nothing but grammar for 8 hours a day, 12 hours a day, year after year after year. Sign me up. We've got adjectives. Adjectives have their own lexical form as well, of course. That might be confused with a noun if you only look at its first part, because adjective endings and noun endings are highly similar. Adjectives, of course, must agree with the nouns they modify in case, number, and gender. So if a noun can take up to 10 different endings, well, an adjective can take up to 30 different endings, because an adjective can modify any gender. So we learned the nominative singular masculine. Let's say it's modifying a feminine noun, and we need to know the nominative singular feminine. What if it's modifying a neuter noun? Then it's got to have a nominative singular neuter. And by looking at the vocab, students recognize which of those sets of endings it might take, depending on what grammatical circumstances. Unavoidable circumstances that must be analyzed with detail at all times. So we keep climbing. And if you've ever done a walk at Delphi, you always stop. The tour guide makes you stop. You have to stop. You can't not look at some of these buildings. But up above, always the mountains as well. And there's always this urge to just keep going. I don't want to look at the Temple of Apollo. I want to get to the top. So we keep going. Grammar. Grammar keeps getting harder, though, as we keep climbing. It was the literature of the classical world itself, of course, not grammar, as narrowly understood, that opened doors. But the study of one made possible an intimacy with the other. And since the languages studied were Latin and Greek, reading literatures presupposed an exhaustive grammatical grounding. Grammar was the fount of eloquence. I didn't find the quote, but I know he said it at some point. You can't take a helicopter to the top. You can't skip it. It's not like in the Matrix where you do this, put it in. Oh, you learned Kung Fu in 4 seconds. As you keep climbing, you start to see rewards. There's the Temple of Apollo, what's left of it. But then you gotta talk about verbs. Nouns are so simple. Adjectives are so unbelievably commonplace. And of course, this is just Latin, where there's only 4 parts of a lexical form for a verb. Greek, which I'm not gonna really talk about today, has 6. Why do they have 4 parts? Well, when I teach English in my Latin classes, English verbs have 3 parts, of course. We must memorize that it's sing, sang, sung. Do we know that it's do, did, done? Are we sure about the correct past tense of lay versus lie? How well do we know the past participle of those? Is it drink, drank, drunk, or is it drunken? Is it drinked? Is it sink, sank, sunk? Is it think, thank, thunk? Do we know these? Kinda, sorta, do we mess them up? Is it correctly written, or is it rode? So very simply, what the Latin verb's lexical form is, first, the first person singular present active indicative, I am, or I praise. The second part is the present active infinitive. Latin has 7 infinitives. Laudare, to praise. The third part, the first person singular perfect active indicative, I praised. And then, of course, our favorite, the PPP, the perfect passive participle, or if you want to look at it in a different way, the accusative supine, laudatum. English doesn't have a supine. It's a verbal noun that we lack. With every verb, we memorize all 4 parts from the beginning. Every verb, you need them. It's the minimum amount of information you must have memorized to deal with any verb. And, of course, we have our English derivative, the useful part. Many students feel like this somewhere maybe in Latin 3. It's a couple of them yesterday in Latin 2 that got the answers correct the first time they tried to do an indirect statement. 5 eighth graders are like, I got them all right after I told them nobody gets these right the first time. You will get them all wrong, guys. When you get to the theater at Delphi, you wanna declare victory because you're done, right? Climb continues. It's never easy. It never gets easy. Latin was not common in the Middle Ages. Or to use the word of the day, vulgar. Vulgar, of course, means of the common people. Which is what attracted those hot for brilliant articulation. It was the language of learning and the coin for the elite, and its use required exacting care. Its vocabulary could make many fine shades of distinction, while its syntax could render them briefly and gracefully. As any student in Latin 4 or 5 realizes, the English takes a lot longer to write out than the Latin. English can't say what Latin says in so few words because of those horrible endings that we hated and got rid of. We were forced to add lots and lots and lots of little words that people have just as much difficulty figuring out how to use. Have you ever heard somebody not use the word of or the correctly, and it's like, what are you saying? Somebody didn't use a possessive, and it made no sense. We keep climbing. Looking down at the theater is more impressive than looking up at the theater. So we memorize hundreds and hundreds of verb forms for one verb. And in Latin 1, our 7th graders memorize all 6 tenses of the active voice and the indicative mood, with all the vowel changes and infixes, and of course all the endings, which aren't always the same in every tense, which stems to derive them from. And we drill, we drill, we drill. You cannot memorize it without writing it out. You cannot memorize it without saying it out loud. Ago, agis, agit, agimus, agitus, agunt. Agebam, agebas, agebat. Agebamus, agebatus, agebant. Agam, ages, aget, agamus, agetus, agent, egi, egisti, egit, egimus, egistis, egerunt, egerum, egeras, egerat, egeramus, egeratus, egerunt, egeru, egerus, egerit, egerimus, egeritus, egerit. This is in 7th grade. As we keep climbing, it's a different mountain, but used for effect. Sometimes when we're climbing, we hit a wall. What do we do with this giant wall in front of us? Keep climbing. In Latin 2, we learn the passive voice, which of course also has 6 tenses. And I tell them, oh, it's easy, it's just, you know, it's a new set of endings, it's stuff you already know. Some students hit the wall when they're trying with their agor, agaris, agatur, agamur, agimini, aguntur, agebar, agebatus, agebatur, agebamur, agebamni, agebantur. And then no one can ever remember agar, agaris, agetur, agamur, agimini, agentur. And then, of course, our perfect system in the passive, which features participles coupled with helping verbs. Octis sum, octis es, octis est. And then you gotta remember that the participle becomes plural along with the help of verb. And it's octi sumus, octi estis, and octi sunt. And then, of course, you have your pluperfect and future perfect forms as well, where you're using different tenses of the helper verb, which is the verb to be, which is already memorized, coupled with the same participle. So octis eram, octis eras, octis erat. Don't forget everything's plural in the plural, so octi eramus, octi eratus, octi erat. And of course, very rare that we say that things will have been done at some point in the future, but we can't not memorize the future perfect passive. Octis ero, octis eris, octis erit, octi erimus, octi eritus, and octi erunt. Many students, of course, come back to where they were a year earlier, and they can't tell way too more. But it takes a couple years to memorize what I just rattled off. Can anyone seriously maintain that such a stiff training in just expression leaves no salutary marks upon the intellect of someone who, having successfully run its gauntlet, becomes captive to the habits of the precise mind? Running the gauntlet? Does that sound about right, guys? But wait, nouns, adjectives, verbs? Ah, it's easy stuff. What about verbal adjectives that retain their verbal powers yet must agree with the noun or noun substitutes that they modify in case, number, and gender? How can something take a direct object and at the same time be in the genitive plural masculine? Well, these are our participles, of course, based on verbal roots, but taking adjective endings. So we learned agens agentis, the present active participle, where we derive agent, one who is doing something. Latin, unfortunately, lacks a present passive participle and a perfect active participle, so I can't make them memorize those. The perfect passive participle, we've already learned that, actus habuum, done or having been done, we get the word act, something that has been done. And although we don't derive anything directly from actus habuum, our future active participle, the equivalent of the verb to be futuris habuum is, of course, where we derive the word future, that which is about to be. And, of course, the best is the last, our gerundive, the future passive participle, which can either show necessity or simple pure futurity, agendis habuum, where we derive agenda, which is, of course, short for a list of agenda, a list of things that are needing to be done. We always analyze neuter plurals as singulars in English and come up with awful expressions like agendas, forgetting that agenda is already plural. We, of course, must learn how to decline our participles. We already know these endings. The perfect passive participle takes the first slash second declension endings, and the present active participle takes third declension adjective endings, specifically third declension adjectives of one termination. But we have our infinitives too. And of course, the dreaded indirect statement, which has no English equivalent, but a simple dependent clause introduced by a that or an implied that. Our dreaded accusative subject with an infinitive that we must translate according to the relationship of its tense to the tense of the main verb. When we talk to kids, we say, okay, I was saying what was happening. What's the relationship of tense? Is it the same? Is it prior? Is it later? What's the difference between I knew what was going on versus I knew what had gone on versus I knew what would go on? We talk about both absolute time and relative time when we get to our participles and infinitives. And of course, we memorize all seven infinitives. Agere, agi, egese, actus habuum, esse, actus habuum, esse. And then of course, we have two future passive infinitives, one expressing necessity, egendus habuum, esse, and one expressing pure futurity, actum iuri. Which is awesome because it's the accusative supine coupled with the hypothetical present passive infinitive of the verb to go. And our eighth graders memorize all of these before spring break. We have eighth graders right now that have already memorized everything you've already seen. That's what comes after spring break. The subjunctive. Only four tenses of the subjunctive, very easy to learn, it's simple vowel changes and infixes. We want to keep climbing though. As has been rightly said, in Latin you must be absolutely right, or you are not right at all. I'm going to print that one out and put it on the wall. But the faultless moments, the ones when our winds fill our sails and the worlds blow perfectly in all their weight and beauty, are the ones we come to live for. They take us halfway up the mountain. We begin to look down on the clouds. So going back to Mr. Mayor and Dr. Robinson facing that wall, right after we got to this, this is Vesuvius we're all at. And it is amazing to look down, and there they are. There are the clouds below us. And of course, that's what it's like at the top. This was our first trip to Italy back in 2012. So what's at the top? Latin 1, Latin 2, we struggle through our forms. We hit our heads on walls. We say drat with noise. But in Latin 3, we finish. We learn the gerund. We learn relative clause of characteristic and how to use the accusative supine properly. And of course, the dreaded fear clauses. And then we start reading. We're fluent. We don't talk. So we can read fluently, we read Caesar, we read Cicero, we read all kinds of historians about Roman history. We read about the Romans in the language they used. Then in Latin 4, we keep reading. We read prose, and then we turn to poetry. But the class I really want to talk about today is the Cadillac of foreign language classes, AP Latin. I love this class. will defend the efficacy and importance of this class to the bitter end. There is nothing better than this class. So, bringing it back to Simmons, the classical world bestowed upon us, upon all who served their youth in its purlieus, a kind of parallel universe. It was once a lens through which to peer and a code to break. Within its rich and peopled precincts, we find personalities, high and low, and conditions, glorious and desperate, that serve as cultural compasses, showing us the distance we have still to travel before the flowering, the realizing of our supreme ideals. They show us our proximity to perfection. So here's what perfection looks like, and here's what perfection sounds like. You guys didn't read this passage. You will know. I talk about a lot of my thesis. I'll talk about my thesis in a little bit, because it's all about the most manly of all things. Aqua lutam, so lutam, corpore. Ah, sorry, it's done. From the top. Aqua lutam, so lutam, corpore quercum, alpini, boreae, non cinc, non flatibus illic. E ruerin ser se certanti stridor et alta consternum terram concusso stipite frondes ipsa ret scopulis et quantum verticar auras aetari as tantum raptici in tartara tendit haud sacusat sit vis hincat quinc vocibus eros tundetur et magno per sensit pectore curas, mens in mota manet lacrimae vulmuntur inanes. Now, of course, non-Latin students take Western Civ, and they take Western Lit, and they know who Dido is, they know who Aeneas is, but for those of you that might have forgotten, and before the Aeneid, Aeneas must deal with relationships. Gray area. A gray area that Virgil makes very gray for the purpose of drama, of course. Aeneas is a widow, and Dido is a widow, and they have come together in Carthage. Aeneas was blown off course, and he shows up in Carthage. Dido's building a new city, and at some point, it is very obvious that he has to leave. The gods come and tell him, you need to leave right now. Jove sends Mercury to tell him, you need to leave. They've been living together in an undefined set of circumstances, which they didn't see a need to define until he says he has to go. But he doesn't say he has to go. He tells his men to start prepping the ships, and he's thinking about the best way to come and tell her that he's leaving, and she accosts him before this happens. He doesn't come off as the best hero at this point, but he does a serviceable job. But she doesn't relent, she doesn't give up, she uses pity, she uses anger, she uses frustration, she sends her sister after him, again and again, to try to talk him into not leaving, or to negotiate some other sort of bargain. And how is this described to us? How can we understand how Aeneas is getting battered? Well, of course, we need an epic simile. What was it like, these yells? Well, it was just like when he's an oak tree, but I can't say that yet in English because it's the direct object. So it's just like when alpine winds strive and struggle between themselves to rip out an oak tree. Not just an oak tree, but a strong oak tree. A strong oak tree with strength. Now, hence, now, thence. Yes, we learn words like hence and thence in Latin. We know that hence means from this place, whereas thence means from that place. Now with gusts. And of course, we make jokes that a derivative of the word for gust is flatulence. But we can say inflate, conflate, etc. if we don't want to make jokes. With gusts from here and there. And the noise goes. And the high leaves strew the ground with the trunk having been struck. But the tree itself clings to the rocks, and just as high as it stretches in its top to the sky, to the upper airs, just as much it stretches down at its root into the underworld. Hardly different than that, our hero is beaten, we derive the word contusion from this verb, with assiduous voices from this place and from this place. Assiduous voices, the ones that sit right at you. And he feels it, he senses it, he perceives it through and through. He perceives his worries, his anxieties, her worries, her anxieties in his great chest. So the tree is beaten and it loses some leaves. The hero is beaten, but his mind remains unmoved. He knows his destiny. He knows his calling. And the inane tears are rolling down. Now, in my thesis, I talk quite a lot about which tears are they. Does he cry here? Does he drop a few tears? But that doesn't matter. Or are these her tears? I could go on and on about it. I kind of wrote a thesis about it. So what do we want? It's not so much of an informed mind we seek, the one full of information for an information age, making us a little more than worker bees, but a certain quality of mind, a mind at once agile and civilized, one able to place the society to which it belongs in some scheme of history. Others say other things. They depart from the hard, specific, and achievable so that they may embrace the soft, indefinite, ungraspable. While spraying sunny ideals with high-sounding words, their advocates seek deliverance in vague, half-realized science and good feelings. They place a naive faith in the capacity of practical know-how to yield all those things that civilized people, people that is, complete individually with souls and collectively with a history, need. And of course these reformers may be right. But what we must know what makes people civilized. Is it merely the sum of their information? Their ability to convert effort into cash? Their hunger to make more gadgets, to perform functions they've yet to question? Their bottomless yen for amusement? Or does civilization require something greater and higher, something harder? I again turn back to Aeneid. Earlier, Aeneas washed up on the shore, a few ships left. They don't know where they are. They go on a scouting mission, and luckily his mom puts him in a cloak of invisibility. So he's wandering around, where he doesn't need to worry what's going to happen to him. And from the top of the hill, he sees the Carthaginians building their city. He sees buildings going up, he sees roads getting paved, he sees people working in specialized tasks, just like the worker bees. And the famous bee simile, unfortunately, didn't make it into my speech today. Because when he saw them working and building and constructing large towers, he did not know if they were civilized. What then made him feel safe? What then made him not worry for his life? Is he going to get captured? Is he going to get arrested? Is he going to get enslaved? Well, they walk up to a temple. And of course, anachronistically, it is filled with relief sculptures as if it's from 5th century Athens. But it's not, but that's neither here nor there. He walks up to the temple. Constitit et lacrimans quis iam locus inquitacate, quae redi inter ris nostri non plena laboris, en priamus sunt hic et iam sua praemia laudi, sunt lacrimae retret mentem mortalia tangunt, soli metus feret haet aliquam tibi fama salutem. He sees a temple. And on the temple in relief sculpture are scenes of the Trojan War, scenes of Trojans losing their war. It's been a few years since the war ended, and Aeneas is amazed. He stops, and weeping, he says, and this is his buddy Achates who's with him, what place now, what region in all the lands is not full of our struggle? Look, it's Priam. Even here, rewards are their own for glory. There are tears of things, and mortal matters touch the mind. Loosen your fear. This reputation will bring some safety to you. What made him know they were civilized? Art. He saw human suffering. He saw that people recognize the human condition, and only then was he assured of safety. And he gives his buddy the pep talk. It wasn't all the buildings. It was the art on the buildings that told him, this is a civilized place, this is a place that is safe, this is a place we don't need to worry about. And he cried. He saw it and he cried. I wrote my master's thesis on crying in the Aeneid. The most manly of topics, because real men read poetry about tears. Why are the tears so important? Not like in Homer, where everybody cries when they stub their toe. Aeneas weeps just a handful of times. And it always matters. It's his pietas, his loyalty to country, the gods, and his family that makes him cry. In fact, there's only one instance when he cries for any other reason, when he realizes that he did cause the death of Dido, and she's really dead, because he knows it, because he's talking to her ghost in the underworld. But in all other times, he mans up, except when it really matters, when his country's at stake, when his family's at stake, when years later he sees the death of his comrades in art. There's no escape. Our aesthetic vocabulary has grown from the classical sensibility. It would not be far off the mark to say that the Greeks and Romans have best taught us how to think and feel. Their greatest medium was their words. And to weigh words in our hands is to measure both their logical power and beauty together. And that's what we do in AP Latin, and to a lesser extent in Latin 4. All the hard work, all the memorization. It's not just so we're training our minds, we're learning how to memorize. It's good for our brains, which it is. It's good to know those endings, all those Latin phrases we use in English. We know exactly what they mean. We can translate them literally. We can go and look at an inscription in Italy and read it. But what does it really do? It lets us read and appreciate high art, the art of words. People have been reading these things for dozens and dozens of centuries, and now is not the time to stop. Do we still need to know how to think and how to feel? Do we still need to know how to be civilized and what it means to be civilized? How many times do we come across a situation in ancient literature that seems so modern to us? Are we still people? So I'll try my best on this one. When in our copied material, this is in the ancient world and in the Middle Ages to a lesser extent, when in our the copied material was not so easily procured, much of what was known collectively dwelled in people's heads, and that which they remembered made up the furniture of their minds. They lived with it. For those who memorize take permanent custody, and this custody confirmed their citizenship within that culture. Heroes defined virtues. Poets conveyed beauty, and their examples were impressed indelibly upon the public mind by the words that armed and ornamented them. Knowledge became personal, intimate, not merely a dry intellectual exercise. Poetry could sing in their heads. Not only did they live with it, they lived by it. So in my next passage here, which if I mess up, that's due to poor preparation. It's a speech I give to students, a speech I give to my own students in class, a speech I give to my leaders in not so many words. Backing up even a little bit, Aeneas has landed on the shore. They've lost ships. The men have struggled through storms. They don't know if they're going to have enough food to eat. And what does Aeneas do? He immediately goes and gets food. But they're downcast. They're downtrodden. He knows they need a pep talk. So he says, oh, so he ib neque mid na risumas ante malorum, o passi gravi ora da piteus hisquoque finem, vos et. Vos et. Vos et skill ag amra bi em penitusque sunam. ignorantes, acesti scopulos vos et Cyclopea saxa experti revocat animos maestumque timorem mittete forsam et haeco li meminisse iuabit per varios casus per tot discrimina rero tendemus in latium sed deis ubi fata quietas ostendunt illic fas regnare surgere Troiae, duratet os met rebus servate secundis. Tale voce effect curis qui gentibus aeger, spem voltu simulat premit altum corde dolore. He says, O allies, O comrades, O friends. And notice that he addresses them first in the vocative, of course. But then he joins them. We indeed are not ignorant of the evils from before. Oh, you guys, having suffered through greater things, graver things, God will give an end to these things as well. You guys have both approached Scylla's rage and the rocks resounding from deep within, and you guys have also experienced the Cyclopean rocks. Call back your high spirits. Send away gloomy fear. Perhaps at one point it will help to remember even these things. Through various hardships, through so many trials of things, we stretch our path into Latium, where the fates show us restful settlements. In that place, it is divine right that the kingdom of Troy rise again. Endure and preserve yourselves for favorable circumstances. And then the best part, of course, back to Virgil. He says such things with his voice and sick. From his huge anxieties, he fakes hope on his face, and he presses his grief deep within his heart. This passage is full of so much. You could talk for hours and hours about this passage. How he goes back and forth from talking to them and then joining them. How he lists the things they've done, and they're never going to forget their struggles, but they will come to an end. But then back to the struggles. They survived Scylla and Charybdis. They survived the Cyclopes and rocks and rocks and rocks. And of course, the derivatives are just dripping from this when we read them as English. Speakers and writers, they've experienced the rocks. They are experts of the rocks. They need to call back their minds, their souls. They need to be reanimated. And they need to send away their gloomy. They need not be intimidated. They need not be timid. And this part right here. First he starts out with something iffy. He's like, perhaps. And you're expecting to see a subjunctive verb, but no. He starts out iffy, but he ends strong with the future indicative. It will be pleasing to us. We derive the word aid, an adjutant from this verb. To remember even these things. Are we not made up of our struggles, our hardships? Do we not grow when we face setbacks? Is this not the speech to be used for ages? I use this speech a lot. He doesn't stop, though. It's not just that we fought against monsters. We had various hardships. Oh, and this word, casus. From cado, cadro, cacini, casum, the verb to fall, or to happen, or to have something befall you. Where do we have cadence and incident and accident and deciduous? And where we get the word case, like a bad case of the cold. or casualty in war, or a cascade. This word embodies anything that might fall into your lap, where the chips fall, the hardships that befall you. And there have been various cases, situations, hardships. Whenever we translate it into English, we always want to say, well, it means hardship slash fall slash situation slash bad stuff. There's never one good word. There's like, we need 9 words. And then this one, discrimina. A crimen is an accusation or a charge or a test. Something that separates the good from the bad. The good from the evil. The experts from the amateurs. Dis. They go away. So discrimina means tests, trials, that which sifts, that which separates, that which discriminates. And then we've got to talk about race, ready, feminine. Thing, matter, situation, circumstance, scenario, affair. This is where we derive republic. The race publica. The public thing. What is a country? What makes the state? Do we say commonwealth? Do we say state? Do we say republic? Do we even know what it means? Well, it's the public thing that is real, in reality, that we realize. And every time we look at it, we're like, well, do we want to say tests of circumstances? Do we want to say trials of matters? And then this one, he brings it back to what their goal is. They've gone through this. They didn't avoid it. And of course, look at pair and pair. Look at the anaphora. They've gone through all these things, but they're still on their quest. Tendemus, we are stretching, we're extending, we're using our tendons. We're going to Latium. They know where they're going. They're going to get there. And, of course, when they get there, they have their restful seats. Or they could be sedentary and incessal. And maybe sedimentary rock will, come about. And they could be quiet. But how do they know about it? The fates are showing it. The fates are being ostentatious. And then, of course, phos. How could I not talk about the word phos? For, fari, fata sum, to speak.